because of this, people have, because of all this, we have been, in every house, there's always been an infestation of various diseases. And as they say that necessity is the mother of all inventions, yoga was already invented many years ago, but because of the boom, because of the lives that we live, which is really fast, it had been lost. But now it has been, you know, revisited in our lives because of diseases like depression, cancer, diabetes, obesity as well. Now we've understood the practicals, we do the practicals, we practice it in our daily lives, but it's always good to know a little bit about the theory as well, of what we are doing, to be aware of what we are doing. Today we have Dr. Jadhav, as we all are aware, to tell us a little bit about yoga and to share his wisdom with us. I would like to present Mr. Sandeep to present a token of appreciation to Dr. Jadhav.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I extend a warm welcome on behalf of Consulate of India to all of you. Let me begin with saying that it's a wonderful sight to see such keenness on your part, the enthusiasm I can see, because being in Dubai for a long time, I can understand the importance of a Saturday. And despite it being a holiday, a valuable day, you are here. Thank you for that. जैसे कि आप सब जानते हैं कि इंटरनेशनल योगा डे इस बार हम 18 जून को मनाने वाले हैं, ना कि 21 जून को. और इस बार दुबई सरकार भी हमारे साथ जुड़ी है, जो कि बहुत ही गर्व की बात है. तो इस बार हमारा और भी अधिक प्रयास है कि पिछले साल से इसलिए हमारा प्रयास है कि इस बार हम पिछले साल से भी अधिक सफलता से इसको बनाए, क्योंकि हमारा हमारे भारत देश के लिए बहुत गर्व की बात है योगा डे. और इसी संदर्भ में मैं अमेरिका योगा टीम का भी धन्यवाद करना चाहूँगा कि वो हमारे इन प्रयासों में वहाँ से जुड़े हुए हैं. और भी खुशी की बात है कि आज के दिन मुझे आमंत्रित किया गया है कॉन्सुलेट की तरफ से, क्योंकि अमेरिका योगा टीम के साथ मैं 2 साल से जुड़ा हुआ हूँ और जिस निस्वार्थ भावना से वो समाज के लिए काम करते हैं मैंने स्वयं देखा है. धन्यवाद. जादव को भी मैं धन्यवाद करना चाहूँगा. लाभ पिछले साल मुझे एक बार मौका मिला उन्हें सुनने का, और जिस तरह से वो योगा को मेडिकल फैक्ट्स और साइंटिफिक फैक्ट्स से जोड़ते हैं इन प्रैक्टिकल टर्म्स, इट्स वर्थ अ हियर आई मस्ट से. तो बिना अधिक समय लिए मैं डॉक्टर जादव से निवेदन करूँगा कि वो स्टेज पर पधारे. I would exhort all of you to please make it sure that we have it in your maximum presence. Thank you.
Some kind or the other in your life. All of a sudden there is an extreme awareness about yoga everywhere, and coincidentally we find for the first time that the entire country is rallied behind this word yoga. There are some unparalleled achievements of the great spiritual country called India. The advances of some of its aspects, right from its philosophy to frontiers of lots of areas, can always be mentioned as being on the forefront, but one secular aspect which has absolutely mesmerized everyone with its precision, and one aspect about which the medical fraternity is constantly exploring unknown aspects of this particular ayam, is yoga. The whole effort of me to talk to you is to create an interactive session with you, to share with you what is the basis of yoga. We do yoga, we have full faith in yoga, we are such Shraddha people, and Shraddha Vanam Labhate Jnanam, so we are taking benefit and advantage of yoga. But won't it be nice if we come to know that the Shraddha that I have about yoga is also based upon the precision oriented medical, not only statistics but the research that is going on all around the world. We'd like to start the whole thing with something called health paradox. How beautiful it is that we call ourselves healthy when we don't visit the hospital, presuming that the one who is in the hospital is sick. The one who is not in the hospital is healthy, and that is the biggest health paradox we have. We intend to be healthy because we don't want to go to the hospital, but we realize that I should be healthy only when I go to the hospital. So when diseased only we think of the health, and when apparently healthy we do not think of disease. Now what you see here is the series of progression that we all have. I'm not naming anyone, but we all have gone through these stages, and going through these stages is definitely not healthy. So this man is sick, he is not healthy. Then comes the question that if that is the case, how do we sort out the health paradox? Yoga defines health as, we never think of health is not an absence of disease, but a positive, happy feeling to be enjoyed 24/7 into 365 till we breathe last. That's what yoga wants from you. Unfortunately, today food is the most abused anxiety drug, and exercise is the most underutilized antidepressant. If we are clear about these two aspects, we can start moving closer to the health. The World Health Organization has beautifully defined health, and this definition dates back to the establishment of WHO, and it says that health is a state of complete physical, mental and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. Now look at the beauty of it. On one hand, there is WHO who has defined health, and we have our own Indian definition of health as per yoga. Let's just try to find out what are the differences. We do four kinds of activity as long as we are alive. We do physical activity, we do mental activity, we do social activity, and there is a fourth activity, name it by any name, it's called spiritual activity. A physical activity results into action, a mental results into feeling, a social into interaction, and a spiritual into inward action. A physical action leads to movement. You move around, that's action. Mentally, you express, or you suffer rather, from an emotion. Socially, you become adaptable, while spiritually you become meaningful. Incidentally, for a physical act or physical part of your health, you do physical acts, which is called as vyayam, exercise or kasrat. For the mental part of it, you have to have a very high emotional IQ, and then you become better emotionally. For social interaction, you have to interact in a proper way with your environment or the external milieu, as they call it, so that you are a well-rounded personality and socially acceptable personality, and that's why you always try to do. Spiritually, what happens is, once you start getting inward thoughts and become more and more meaningful, then you start becoming a spiritual person. It's got nothing to do with the religious aspect, but you start becoming spiritual in a different way. And you do that physical act for survival, you do that mental act for survival, you do social act for survival, and spiritual act also for survival. The biggest part is, any act that is done to take care of all the four in a proper balance is called health in yoga. Well, WHO refers to only the first three. The difference is the completeness of health won't be there unless everything is included into it. And mind well, there is no semblance of religion anywhere into this particular definition. Now comes the question as to if this is what we need to do, we must need to know what human body is all about. The statement, "I stand in the awe of a temple called my body," is a statement by the great thinker who influenced Mahatma Gandhi to a great extent, Henry Thoreau. The gentleman who said that if I don't exercise, I'm as good as a dead wood. And the gentleman who never dressed properly except on occasions when he went to visit a tree. And the gentleman who wrote thought-inspiring Walden, he said, "I stand in the awe of a temple called my body." Now the question is, how important is human body? How was it created? When did we start walking on our feet? When we started walking on our feet, that was an adoption in the evolution for a certain purpose. And the purpose of human body was basically for gathering food, defending enemies, interacting with environment. This is what the human body is meant for. It is an instrument for gathering food and hunting, and it requires, since it requires walking, climbing, occasional sitting, and it's occasional sitting, it requires flight, fright and fight response whenever there is an enemy. When there is no enemy, this response system is expected to be shut off and it interacts with the environment in a responsible manner. This is what human body is made for. And what is human body right now doing? Instead of what are our activities? We spend least possible time in food gathering. It requires a walk to a supermarket, the food is gathered. Then what do? We do not walk, we do not run, we do not climb, and we perpetually sit. So much is sitting in our life that there is a connotation that is slowly taking shape in medical field called sitting disease. It's simply because you sit, so you get the disease. It has nothing to do with infection. It has nothing to do with infestation. It has only one thing to do, and that's sitting. What is happening about defending ourselves? We have no enemies. No tiger is coming to eat us now. But what is happening is, there is a continuous state of perceived fear and anxiety. Suppressed emotion, the anger, the jealousy, the deceit. And then what is happening? Since the enemy is not seen, but the unseen enemies are many, the body is constantly in the state of fight, fright and flight. And that is where we find a big long queue in front of a cardiovascular clinic for what we call as excess of tension, simply referred as hypertension. Coming to this destroying environment, we have created artificial environment around us. We do not stay in natural environment. We have shut off ourselves from the winds that was blowing around us. We have shut off ourselves from the trees that we were having around us. We stopped smelling flower. We have stopped really having a nice sunlight in the morning. And then what is happening is we have developed allergies to all of them. The tree is no more close to me. I have an allergy about it. The flower is no more close to me. I have an allergy about it. The sun is not close to me, so I get sun allergy. So I am in a controlled environment. So what has happened is, by my scientific progress, I have reversed the rule of human body and completely changed it in a manner whereby my original roles have been completely obliterated, and then as a reward to that, I have been rewarded by the Almighty with n number of diseases. Today, on our daily basis, our body is a source of complaint. Our body is a source of discomfort. The instrument through which I'm supposed to enjoy my interaction with the environment is at fault. And when, if my instrument is at fault, there is no way I can ever enjoy the interaction or my mere presence itself. And that is why I need to do what I am not doing. And the simple definition of doing what I am not doing is exercise. Then comes the question that why is exercise important? We can see exercise has been defined in different ways. you have previous time. A forgotten act and art of purposeful human living is exercise. It's a very simple definition. Why do you need to have your body toned up? Why you want your body to be absolutely in healthy condition? Because that is how it is supposed to be. Since it is not that way, I'm trying to resurrect myself to my original position. And that's why it is a forgotten act and art both. It's a forgotten act and it's a forgotten art also. Why it is called as a forgotten art? Because even today, there are many, many of them who know exercise is needed, but they do not know what type of exercise, how much, when, gymnasium, aerobics, swimming, adventurism, dance classes, samba, salsa, what exactly should I do? And how do I know that what I'm doing is the right kind of exercise? Because after a couple of years, the medical science comes forward and says that do not do that, because that has been proved to be not good. So what is important now is, from the Western explanation point of view, if you look at why exercise is important, it is important for weight control, increasing the metabolism, having healthier heart, reduced blood pressure, strengthening immune system, improved self-image, toned muscles, relieving stress, increasing self-esteem, increasing energy, and stronger bones and joints. This is what the Western outlook towards exercise is. What about the Eastern outlook? The Indian view of exercise is slightly different. It includes all that has been said earlier in the Western outlook, but Shariram Adhyam Khalu Dharma Sadhanam. A very simple definition, why do you need to exercise is because Shariram Adhyam Khalu True Dharma Sadhanam. Whatever I intend to do, whether it is a good actor or a bad actor, or whatever I intend to do, any action that I want to do, I must have the instrument in proper order. If I try to embark upon a travel with a broken car, it is not a rocket science to know that I will never reach my destination. And in addition to that, what I am intending to do is either I will be doing dharma, artha, kama, moksha. There is no fourth function that a human being can do. Forget about the religious connotation, whatever it may have had. But simple thing is, all the acts that a human being does can be put into these four categories. Whichever act you want to do, and let's say today, we have perhaps left dharma on one side because it is on the side. We have left moksha on the other side because it is on the other side. That leaves us only with two, the earth and the kama. Even that has been considered as a purusharatha. Fair enough, go ahead and do it. But to do that also, you need a sound body. I recently came across a gentleman who happens to be a billionaire. Precisely $1.9 million is the net worth. I'm not naming him, he belongs to this place. I happened to just bump across him, and after he was walking with an unsteady gait and he sat at one place, it took about 10 minutes to walk 5 meters of distance. I just happened to reconfirm myself that is he so and so? And Pat gave the reply, yes, he is so and so. What has happened to him is that umpteen number of diseases, and on the top of it, a disease which is Alzheimer's. So I own $1.9 million, I don't know. I own it. I don't know. Everybody else knows it. Now, if that is the kind of situation, the middle two also are not possible. And not only that, the Indian view of health also says that mere absence of disease is not health. I shall be 24/7, 365 days a year, as long as my last breath is there, I should have chitta vritti prasannata. I should feel that I am enjoying health. Health is a thing to be enjoyed. Health is not a thing where we say that in a moment I sit on the sofa, set and couch, or get up after 5 minutes, I need to really slowly bend myself. These days my knees hurt. These days I can't bend. I'm not able to lift my grandson. I've been told by doctors not to move sideways. Whenever we are coming across this kind of situation, be sure there's something wrong because we are not enjoying the health. Now the question is, the neuroscientific model of mind, now we all talk about mind, the medicine doesn't recognize mind. But what medicine recognizes is these three aspects. There's a system called brainstem limbic system in the body. What it does is, it basically talks about general and specific arousal of the organization. I know I'm talking to you, but simultaneously I know at least 100 things. I know I'm upright. I know my feet are right at the place. I know this hand, when I do the gestures, it's not hitting this particular board. I know the distance between this and this board. That's called metria, that my cerebellum is taking care of. I'm looking at you and trying to see whether you have really understood what I'm talking or not. One aspect of my brain is constantly functioning. All this work, and I also know that I am aware of the fact that I'm talking on a subject called yoga in front of the people who are there in Dubai. I don't have to remind myself again and again that this is Dubai. Because somewhere in the back of mind, my brain tells me, don't worry, I know about it. That's called arousal, awareness, self-awareness. There's another system called non-specific thalamocortical system. It's a very complicated, bizarre word, which belongs to the brain. What it does besides precisely is, it is unity of awareness with cognizance of self and surrounding. You'll be surprised when you drive to your office, you're talking on the phone, that your foot, whichever you're using, he knows how much to accelerate. And the other one is not putting too much pressure on the brake. You're not looking down. It is happening. It knows how much pressure has been put there. It knows how much acceleration has been given. You're talking to somebody. Somebody tries to cut you across and you immediately stop it. All that is happening simultaneously because there is an awareness of self called proprioception. That's what brain does. I'll give you a small example. This will make it very clear. There is a disease, a central nervous system disease, in which a gentleman is on the bed. His mother walks to him and the doctor asks the patient, who is she? He says, oh, she's my mother. I said, okay. Are you not going to say good morning? He said, no. That's very surprising. Your mom has come to see you and you're not greeting her. All right. Then the mother goes to the next cabin, away from him, picks up a telephone and calls him and says that, son, how are you? And he starts crying. Mom, I am remembering you. Isn't it so funny? Because what has happened is, he sees his mother, so he knows that she is mother. But knowing that she is mother is one function of the brain, but she is my mother, emotional appeal, is another function. In that disease, those neurons are cut. So only one neuron is alive. So when the mother walks from the front, he says, she is my mom, but there's no emotional arousal. But when she speaks on the phone, the auditory, the reflexes coming from the ear are still alive. So immediately he realizes, oh, it's my mother, and he starts crying. How intricately the brain works. And believe me, brain tries to keep itself up for a very long time because in spite of all unhealthy habits, it does not, even by 1.1%, deviate from its normal functioning. And the third aspect is the specific thalamocorticostriate network. What it does is, it talks about everything that is concerned with language, memory, cognition, cognition. So all these aspects, now these three aspects together in medicine are called higher functions. In India, in our kind of a scenario, we call it mind. But in either case, this is the area from where everything gets coordinated. Now, what is the reason when I'm talking about yoga and I'm trying to get into the depth of it is because as we move forward, I would like to emphasize upon certain aspects of yoga which we have not taken into account, but the medicine has taken into account. And believe me, the current research on yoga is more concentrated on this area than any other area. If there are a few asanas that are going to control your lumbosacral pain or the backache, it's not a big deal. A diamond is hard. That's one of its criteria. Diamond is a diamond. Yoga does cure some element of yours, but it has an ability to cure far more than what you and we can think of. And the whole object of this speech is to give you a glimpse, if possible, of how medicine has recognized that particular potential. What are the health issues that we get in case we don't exercise? Look at the obesity structure worldwide. Naturally, anything that affects health, there's one top country which is always at the top, United States of America. So you have maximum obesity there. And then you find all of them. Incidentally, we do not have India in the list of obese countries which I have depicted here. But there's no point in taking a solace in this fact because India at present is not into the obesity chart in this chart that I have shown, but the way it is marching towards that, that is something worth interesting. India has the largest diabetic population in the world, about 33 million, and that's not enough. WHO had projected that it will reach 100 million by 2024, more years. Believe me, we are 1.3 billion, and there are going to be 100 million diabetics. And that's not all. Has also predicted that the country by then would have an equal number of cardiac patients. What would that mean? It would mean every sixth Indian will either be a diabetic or a heart patient. And believe me, India is a country of young population. And that's how every one of us have heard about situations like he was 25. It's not an age to get a heart attack. He was 30, he was 35. And believe me, we live in an area where in an era where there's no infection. You can't die of infection these days, not possible, because we have excellent health system everywhere, right? And yet, we are dying from diseases which are not infective in origin. What it indicates is something is seriously wrong with our health. Moving to the obesity, now you can see India stands third. Why we stand third? Because we are fastly progressing towards, we are becoming an obese nation. I am talking about obesity of India. 5 to 10 years hence, I shall be reversing these maps. We will be there on the obesity chart. If you look at this, the countries which are getting obese, and see how fast they are moving up. 1980, the female obesity was 29%, it is now 38%. So with the reason, there's a new disease called sitting disease. Now what happens with the sitting disease is, you can see that 86% of US workers are standing at least sitting 8 to 10 hours a day. Now with that, what is happening is, a person who sits for 10 years, I'm not talking about any other predisposing factors, person who sits for 10 years is likely to get twice the chance of colon cancer simply because he sits. What it means is, the movement of the body that is meant for standing, walking, climbing, going down, going up, has been restricted to a fantastic chair, a CEO chair or a clerk's chair, it is a chair. So that means, what it means is, more you start sitting longer, the chance that you will become horizontal are very high. And that's why, is it an evolution or an extinction? We took hundreds of millions of years to come to that second last stage, but the last one is where we are standing now. With that kind of situation, won't be a surprise if you start regressing ourselves into the situation. Now, question comes that understood. I understood about obesity, I understood about problems. The biggest question is, which exercise should I do? There are umpteen number of exercises available and umpteen number of advices available. Someone comes and says that, boss, there's a gym there. I tell you, this is so good. We go there, do it for 2-3 months, pay money for that. Get up early in the morning and go there. We do not find that it has really given what I really intend to have. Then the youngsters come and they say that, no, unless I have a physique of some of those stupid heroes which are seen in the cinemas, and they do not tell you that they go for their neck pain and other things to yoga, that they never explain and never tell you that. But they become our heroes and we try to follow them. And this touch and go phenomenon with different type of exercises is what we've been doing all along. That's why we never got a distinct result. Now, in terms of exercises, the major exercises in terms of medicine are either aerobic or anaerobic. What is the basic difference? Aerobic meaning, I am going to do an exercise that shall give me the required oxygen, because when I exercise, my demand for oxygen increases. I have two ways of getting that oxygen. One is, let's call it in a normal way. My body is able to take the increased oxygen from the environment and yet keep up pace with the exercise that I'm doing. But a time comes when my body is not able to utilize the oxygen that is coming from the environment, and then it starts creating energy sources from other places like muscles, and that is what is called anaerobic respiration. So anybody who does an anaerobic exercise is bound to get lots of productions of lactic acid and carbon dioxide. Both are not very good things for the body. So one simple rule is, anything that is anaerobic. Then the question comes, who does anaerobic exercise? Usain Bolt, maybe he needs. We are not Usain Bolt. Somebody who wants to run about, there are people who run 360, 350 kilometers. I know of people who run ultra marathons, they go on for 4 days, 4 nights. Now that kind of exercise, if somebody does, let them be. These are the people who require anaerobic exercise. But otherwise, anybody who does anaerobic exercise is inviting lots of dangers, medically speaking. And this all comes under that. Now, when we say anaerobic, this can be, it's not that tennis is bad. Tennis is not bad. The question is, tennis in a particular way can be bad for you. And when it comes to giving advantages to me, it gives me an advantage of a particular type. If I get involved into squash, I run quite a lot because I'm moving from one point to another point. So it gives me a fantastic exercise for my thighs, for my hamstrings, for my calf muscles. Fantastic. But there's very little I do for my back because it doesn't require back. I go for swimming and then it does give me an adequate amount of flexibility because then I'm doing some strokes and all that, but it doesn't give me strength. So either you have something in it, but something is missing from it. So how many types of exercises are you going to do? I'll give you an example of Arnold Schwarzenegger, the gentleman who was 7 times Mr. Olympia and 8 times Mr. World, etc. Different fact that he underwent a cardiac surgery. I don't know how many of us are aware of it. But the fact is, he used to do swimming for fitness. For strength, he used to do weightlifting. And he was a hero from Hollywood, so he could afford all that. The question is, I am a common man. I cannot take chances. I cannot give up much time. I have to look after my family. I have to do my job. So I need an exercise of a completely different type. So if given a choice, I shall prefer aerobic exercise. And in aerobic, you have a brisk walking, one of the simplest exercises which many of us try to do. Then we have dancing, jogging, bicycling, skating, swimming, treadmill, roller skating. We all know that we all have tried this. And it won't be an exaggeration if I say that most of the treadmills in the houses are used for drying clothes. That's because there's no consistency about it. And why the consistency is not there? It's not because only the determination is not there. It is because it is not giving me what I want. I need some kind of encouragement so that I'm propelled forward to do a particular thing. So that means if I'm able to lead a life where I do not have much of a muscle mass to show to somebody, but I'm healthy, happy, I'm sleeping nicely, I'm kind of walking around beautifully, my mind is constantly giving me a feel that I'm absolutely energetic, then perhaps I'll be motivated to do that exercise. Now the question is, what is an ideal exercise? And all these are aspects of medically proven. It should take care of my physical fitness, that's right. It should take care of my mental fitness, healthy mind. It is aerobic. It has no chance of injuries. How many exercises can get out of this, we all know that. Then it suits all ages. Another important criteria, it suits all types of people, irrespective of whatever you are. Then it is easy to learn. It does not require any instrument. You don't have to go to a gym. You don't have to buy about 50,000 worth of a treadmill in your house. It should be cost free. It can be done at any place, at any time, with less preparation. It should have centuries of proven history, right? Then it is evaluated by modern medicines for effectiveness and accuracy. I have deliberately put it in the bold. Then comes, it should cater to the strength, stamina and flexibility all at once. It cannot give only one part of it, it should give all at once. Then comes, it should work positively on parasympathetic nervous system as well as endocrine glands. Now, we all know I have thyroid. There are so many of them, they are taking medicines about thyroid. They have pancreas, they have liver, they have exocrine and endocrine, both kinds of glands, and they are suffering from it. Now, what is exercise for glands? There is no exercise for glands, because glands are not muscles. So there has to be some way whereby I can keep them healthy. So there has to be an exercise which takes care of those glands. And in our body, there are two different systems that work. One is called as the somatic nervous system, that means the nervous system which is under my control. I lift this hand because I wanted to lift the hand, so my thought that I'm going to lift this hand is enough for me to put my muscles into action to hold it. But that is a somatic nervous system. Behind that, there's a nervous system called autonomous nervous system. Now this autonomous nervous system is called autonomous because it's not under my control. It works on its own, but it has very important functions to perform. What happens when I'm about to face the interview? I suddenly start sweating. my heartbeat goes up. Sometimes I feel like going to the toilet quite often. It happens exactly and precisely at that time. And you always feel that, I don't know why it should happen now. No, it's not happening because of you. It's happening because of that autonomous nervous system. It's giving a response to that particular fight, flight, or fright. You're scared of something. You're defending yourself against those situations. The question is, this is a kind of a defense that nature has given us on certain occasions. If I keep defending myself throughout the day, what will happen to my system? And that's precisely what happens with most of us in our current lifestyle. So I must have an exercise system which takes care of that, and it can be done in part or full depending upon the availability of time. I can't go and just do barbell and come back. What will happen? I shall have a fantastic biceps and I'm absolutely like a stick my legs. So it can't be done in part. It has to be done for the whole body. In yoga, I just feel like today a shortened version of yoga. I can do an elongated or extended version of yoga. I can do certain asanas today, certain I can leave them to be done next day or next week. The question is, flexibility is pretty good here. Then comes the last, it should be accessible to reach as well as poor. It's a very important criteria. How many of us can afford medicines? How many of us can afford exercise now? Because it's become so expensive. Anything that fits into all of this, there's none except you. And that's why we are trying to focus on yoga, because this is one exercise about which a very confident exercise advice can be given by a trained personnel who is normally referred as Guruji or Guru, as we call it. The very reason we call him Guru is because he has undergone all those exercises under the guidance of his Guruji, so that while performing them, you may not be injured, but you may not get full benefits. The 100% benefit and how critical they are, we will come to know only when we go through certain books medically written about yoga. In fact, the precision with which our ancestors have given this science to us is so precise that sometimes it mesmerizes us when we juxtapose that with the researches that are done in medicine, and we'll see some of them now. In case of the current awareness of Western world of medicine, this is just an enlistment of few important names just to convince you that what is happening on medicine. Dr. Dean Ornish is a California-based cardiologist. In 1990, he published his research paper. It is considered to be the second most important paper in cardiology for patients already suffering from coronary blockages. Mind well, he treated few thousand patients of heart elements where either they have had an heart attack or they were declared 90%, 70%, 80% blockages, and he intended to treat them without operation, without bypass, without angioplasty. And he was not somebody who just started some center at some other place. He was a qualified doctor of medicine, head of department, whose research was so powerful and so accurate that it got published into the most prestigious publication called Lancet. So it came in the Lancet, and why he moved towards this was Yogi Sachidananda ji. He came in his contact, learned yoga. Unlike you and me, he did not leave yoga there. He took it to the logical conclusion and he wanted to find out, is it really what Guruji says can happen? And when he saw that it can happen with him, he started using it for the patients. And believe me, irrespective of the kind of history, there were some patients with 3 or 4 heart attacks, myocardial infarcts, already some of the tissue dead in the heart, treated by him in his clinic. If anybody is interested in this kind of work, there is a book written by him called Reversing Heart Disease. A beautiful book to read, based on absolute correct statistics and medical criteria. So that is when suddenly the Western world started looking towards yoga. And I'm talking more of medical fraternity. The second book is by Dr. Marion Garfinkel. What she does is, there's a syndrome called carpal tunnel syndrome. This is a gift to us because of computers. We put our hands like this and we move our fingers like this. As if this is not enough, the youngsters have started doing this. So with this, what happens is you get a compression of a median nerve right here, because there is a band here. God has given us a band here, and through under that band the nerve passes forward and the nerve controls this movement. Because you keep doing this again and again, this band becomes tight and the nerve gets compressed and you start getting numbness here and it pains. All such cases, and there is an epidemic of carpal tunnel in America. This is their word, not my word. And mark me, carpal tunnel syndrome is treated by a surgery where we cut that band and make the nerve loose and he becomes better. So there is a surgery for it. She is the first lady who treated thousands of cases of carpal tunnel syndrome and declared cured. So now it is a standard treatment for carpal tunnel syndrome is yoga. Moving to the third one, Dr. David Coulter. It's an interesting thing. In fact, what I'm speaking, majority of this is based on this book, David Coulter. Who is this David Coulter? There is a gentleman of, he wrote a book called Anatomy of Hatha Yoga. He's a professor of neuroscience, microanatomy at University of Minnesota. 25 years of research. 25 years. As if it was not enough, he spent 10 years in Himalayas. Mind well, he's a medical guy. And then when Guruji, Swami Rama, was his guru, he told him, next time you're not going to enter this ashram unless you write a book. And that's when he started writing a book on based on 35, 40 years of experience, including personal experience, and that is a book called Anatomy of Hatha Yoga. He has mentioned everything in this book accurately as per the medical anatomy. Only things that he has not commented is about prana, nadi and chakra. He is convinced about it. But he could not write about it because the medical science doesn't know where is prana. We know oxygen, we know carbon dioxide in the blood, we have a meter to calculate it, we have PCOG, PO2, we don't have P prana. Because prana is where does it exist? But it does exist. Maybe we are too early to talk about it. That's why he left it. In that book, he hasn't spoken anything about chakra, because where are those chakras? And there are some misconception about chakras. Some people call solar plexus as a particular chakra, which is not so. Those chakras, those vayus, those pranas, those rakta shuddhi, another word commonly used in most of the Ayurvedas as well as yoga. Rakta shuddhi is that you're not infected, your blood cannot take even 0.1% more carbon dioxide than what you have inside. So when we refer to rakta shuddhi, we're talking about higher oxygen saturation. It's not that you're suffering from some kind of a poison in your blood. So those are the words that he's left aside. Dr. Sarah, she's studied on positive effect of yoga on parasympathetic system. What she did is very simple. All the patients of blood pressure were her targets. She called those patients, evaluated them medically by doing yoga and meditation together, and she conclusively proved that for dropping the blood pressure on a consistent basis, you can reverse it by using yoga in the right manner. Then comes the question of Dr. Paula. What she has done is, now this is where, you know, very, very interesting research has come out. Whenever you have an inflammation in the body, any kind of inflammation happening in the body, tonsillitis, pharyngitis, all itis, whatever we see, all itis is called inflammation, and inflammation leads to certain changes in the body. And the immediate change is release of a protein called C-reactive protein. We call it CRP. Yoga has conclusively been proven by this lady that there is a drastic drop of CRP. Now, why this is important for us? We all know that there are lots of inflammation that are going on in our body which we are not aware of. Whenever we talk about a backache, what is happening there is definitely an injury to the ligament of the muscle and there is an inflammation there. We take that inflammation very lightly unless it becomes too much and then we visit an orthopedician. That's why yoga has a role to play against the inflammation. The next doctor is Elizabeth Blackburn. Now, this is something very interesting. She won Nobel Prize in 2009. Now, this is something which I want you to really listen carefully. She worked on cell division, how one cell becomes two, two becomes four in human beings. And then she found out there is a phase called telophase, one of the phases while cells are duplicating. In that phase, there is an enzyme called telomerase. Now, what is so important about this enzyme? They have found out, it has already been proved, that telomerase is the enzyme responsible for aging. When you start having aging process, telomerase definitely goes down. What was surprising was, this lady, 2009 Nobel Prize winner, did a research and she proved that by 12 minutes of daily yoga meditation, 12 minutes, see the figures are very important, 12 minutes of yoga meditation, the telomerase activity was up by 43%. And this enzyme is also called as immortality enzyme. What it means is, in terms of recovery of body, we always use the word recovery. When you say recovery, there is a lot of role yoga can play. And then comes John Denninger. He is a psychiatrist at Harvard Medical School. What he did is, he did a 5-year study and he realized that yoga switches on and off the genes responsible for stress and immune function. A straight study that focused on the gene responsible for stress. There's a number for the gene, it's pretty long. He worked on it and proved that immunology, so yoga boosts immune system. So far we heard about it, but there's a basis for it. And it works against stress. Now you must have been to a number of doctors, unfortunately. And all of them, with every disease, now have started adding one word. It's because of stress. Oh, you got a sugar problem, it's because of stress. You know, sleeping problem, it's because of stress. Or what happens? Yeah, I mean, if you have stress, the back also starts spinning. Everywhere that word stress is coming again and again. And more it comes, more and more yoga becomes relevant. There is some misconception about yoga that I want to clarify. It's yoga for Westerners, it's yoga for us. Let's respect the word. It's yoga, not yoga. That's their word. Our word is yoga. Because yoga word comes from a dhatu called yuja. It's a Sanskrit word. Let's respect that word. And it has a very high philosophical and esoteric meaning. It's not expected for a normal student to reach to that particular level, but it comes from that source. So let's respect the word. It's yoga, not yoga. Prana is one word. Now we do pranayama. The whole ayam is for the prana, and medical science doesn't know where the prana is. That's why the misconception about prana is oxygen. Oxygen abates prana. Dr. Coulter, about whom I spoke, he says what is will and what is volition. Will we don't know. Will is this. Volition is mind. That's how he separated itself. Similarly, oxygen is medical term. Prana is a cumulative function of oxygen. So oxygen is used as a radical for achieving something, that controlling aspect of body, utilizing oxygen in a proper manner is where prana comes into the picture. And that is why prana is divided into four parts. Oxygen is same from the tip of the toe to the top of the head. Pranas are not same on the five parts. Specialized function, specialized role, and that role has been given in that particular manner. Chakra, all the chakras, the shad chakras, we are working, whenever we are doing yoga, we are working towards the chakras, whether you want it, whether you don't want it. The fact is, you may not be expert in knowing the, not knowing the names of the chakras, but the fact is that it is the chakras that control everything. The question is, the misconception is, chakras are not to be confused with the medical plexuses that we see. So do not call a sacral or a caudal plexus as Muladhara chakra. These are different aspects. What are they? Why are they there? There's a different science for it. Do not shun simply because you're not aware of it. It is a deep and much esoteric science. And the last is Rakta Shuddhi. It's a common word used. What we mean by that is, higher the oxygen saturation in the blood, the blood is more able to perform the function that it is supposed to perform. Moving forward, we want to now see exactly how. Am I going too fast? Am I okay? Is it audible? What we intend to now see is, after all, what is body? What you see in front of you as Dr. Jadhav is basically what you see is an external part, the outer surface. Each and every one of us are basically interplay of systems, which are called basically the body systems. Now what happens is, the single most smallest unit is cell, we all know that. The cells come together to form a tissue. The tissue comes together to form an organ. The organ comes together to form a system. And such multiple system forms one Dr. Jadhav. Now what are those main systems? That there are many of them. There are many subsystems also. But on a, broadly speaking, we have a nervous system. We have a circulatory system, a respiratory system, a digestive system, a skeletal system, and a muscular system. Why I am showing these six is because if you do exercise, whichever it may be, if somebody wants to challenge anybody saying that yoga is not the ultimate exercise, there is something else, I shall accept it provided it works on all the system at the same time. It has to take body as one unit for the exercise. Yoga does that. Because the origin and evolution of yoga itself is based on clear and proper understanding of the systems. David Calder's words which he has used in the system are very, very important for us. He says, I do not know how. these sages, because we don't know who started yoga. Somebody compiled it, we know his name. But who started, because Rishis, Munis have been doing it for ages together. So he said, I do not know how they knew about it, but the precision of their knowledge about the anatomy of the body is simply marvelous. That's what Dr. Kaulduk talks about it. Moving down to the first system, this is the most important system. You will see that in yoga, the major emphasis of body system is on respiratory system. It's not that it doesn't do anything about other system, it does. It talks about skeletal system, there are different asanas, it talks about circulatory system, but everything works mainly and majoritarily through respiratory system. And why is so? The reason is, the sages had understood that the most important system in the body is respiratory system. Now, we all know that why this system is made so important, because all I need for my body to function in a finer manner is my individual cell does not eat roti and tandoori. My individual cell, what it needs is oxygen and sugar. That's all it needs. Now, you give it in any form. You've been given a digestive system, you put chicken into it, you put roti into it, whatever you want to put into that meal, that's not a problem. At the end, the cell requires oxygen and sugar. Now, the question is, sugar comes from the food. The most important element, oxygen, comes from the air. Now, if my food, the problem now with my food is, it is important for me, the problem of food now is not having the food, having it more is a problem. So I don't have to really care about what I do need to care about what I eat. But will I get food or not is not my problem. It's bound to be there on my dish. The problem is I'm having it aplenty, too much. What about oxygen? The biggest problem is my oxygen does not reach where it is expected to reach. And that's why first thing what you need to do is ensure, and the sages knew, that even the animals or the monkeys or the man, he will definitely go for his food and he'll gather the food somehow. The problem when it comes to the air or the oxygen, there are issues that the oxygen may not reach to his systems in adequate quantity, under adequate pressure, in adequate concentration. Now, the reason why it happens is, we all know that it starts from the nose. Apparently, it's a nicely looking thing and two holes there and the air is moving in. It's not as simple. You go in Himalayas, it's snowing everywhere, it's so cold that you've been putting at least 3-4 thermals on the body, but the air that you are breathing is still cold. How much cold the body should feel inside when the air moves in? But before air enters beyond this point, it becomes warm. That's how the God has made it. Now the air, when it comes inside the nose, it moves. And in that movement, it gets friction, it becomes hot, and it is sufficient temperature for the body to inhale inside. Otherwise, if you could have inhaled the same cold air, we could have been in the hospital. But that happens because of this nose. And then, because of this happens in the nose has a certain structure inside, and that structure is called sinuses. Now, the sinus is nothing else but right here when I'm pointing, there's a hole behind my finger. There's a bone here called maxilla. Right inside it, if I penetrate, it will go inside a hole. There's a small pouch of air there called maxillary sinus. Then there is a sinus here called frontal sinus. There's a sinus called ethmoid. There are small pockets there where the air goes in, moves out, and then goes inside, and then becomes warm. What a fantastic structure God has given. But problem with us is, we do not keep it clean. As if it is not clean, we smoke. If you don't smoke, we have enough dust outside. If you don't have dust outside, there will be something happening, the diesel fumes will be coming. All this when it goes inside, imagine the same air, whether it is pure or impure, nose is supposed to breathe it. When it takes it inside, that same air, which is full of carbon, because it came just from the windpipe of that, the carburetor pipe of the front vehicle, so it moves inside and recirculates, and then what happens? The smooth mucosal lining gets affected. Who is going to clean it? The God has given small hair-like things there to clean it. So what it does is it releases a lot of fluid. So the fluid, you know what it is, the mucosal secretion. And the cilia, the small hairs, they keep propelling that outside so that the dirty particles, that's why sometimes you say, look at my thing, you know, I came from the local, my whole handkerchief is black. That black what we call about is what you see, how much microscopic particles would be there inside. And then what happens is, that is the reason why majority of us are suffering from sinusitis. A very common condition. In fact, it is bread and butter of ENT surgery. It is so common. The question is, how do I take care of it? That's where yoga has a role to play. Once the air starts coming in there, then you have what is called as pharynx, larynx, and then there are two lungs there. There's a left lung, there's a right lung. This much we all are aware of. Coming to the lung part of it. Now this is something very, very interesting. Why yoga is so critical and how beautiful it works on the respiratory system is, if you see the right and the left lobe, there's a central tube that goes left and right, then again redivides, then again redivides. It undergoes about 23 to 25 times it redivides. And then, after the complete redivision, what happens is, you get what is called as, this is the last part of that particular tree. This last part is called alveolus. Alveolus because it looks like grape. The meaning of alveolus is it looks like grape. And it does look like grape. It is transparent because it's very thin. That's where on the top of it you see those blood vessels. There's a blue blood vessel there and there's a red blood vessel there. What is happening is, those blood vessels have come on the top. They slowly give carbon dioxide outside and they slowly take oxygen inside. This is constantly going on there. What I've inhaled has come down through the tubes, through the tubes, through the tubes, through the alveolus. When it comes to the end of alveolus, then from that alveolus the oxygen seeps through, goes into the artery and then goes forward. Imagine from there it is going to go to your heart. From heart it is going to go to each and every cell of your body. How much oxygen is traveling? Now the question is, this particular thing, what happens is when it ultimately reaches the cell, what happens in the cell is the oxygen is taken by the cell and it converts what is called as adenosine diphosphate, ADP, to what is called as adenosine triphosphate. Now what does this mean, ADP and ATP? What it means is it releases energy. So the energy that you feel, the energy that you require to do anything is basically when I do this, I spend a couple of millions ATPs. Now to do this, the ATP is required came because I'm breathing. That oxygen has gone there, somebody is regulating it there. Such a beautiful craftsmanship is happening on the back of the mind. I'm not aware of it, but the body is working on it. Now when that is happening, the overall situation we have seen that the air is going to come from outside. So what I breathe should be nice and pure as far as possible. Then when it goes down, it should go precisely the way it is coming. It should not stop anywhere. And why will it stop? Suppose I'm suffering from common cold. How much oxygen can go inside? Your one nostril is blocked. So anyway, you are now 50% ability of taking your oxygen inside. After I've taken the oxygen inside, I have a pharyngitis and so many other things. Then I have asthma. My bronchi are collapsing. Those three that I'm talking about, they are collapsed. Now imagine a tube and an oxygen is moving inside it, but there's a lot of fluid inside. The oxygen is finding it difficult. What happens when you switch on sometimes the tap and the air comes out? The water doesn't come out. It makes some kind of a noise. Precisely the same noise we make when we have a wheeze. We call it a wheeze. Right? Now when that happens, this is a part going back from that back to the sinuses. These are the sinuses I've explained. See the sinus which is inflamed on the left side, the sinus which is nice on this side. Now what is important is, amongst the Shuddhi Kriyas that we do, which are ably demonstrated by Guruji here, is one of that is the Neti that we do. Now we all know that the Neti pot is everybody has seen it. We do our Neti from one side to the other side. So what we are precisely doing is we are putting our water from one side of the sinus and taking it out from the other side of the sinus. It's a smooth and it is not blown. It is poured. It moves like a trickle, goes to the other side. And imagine when body's own fluid can take out so much of dirt, when it is added and abated by some water, clean water, warm water going from one side to the other side, what will happen? It will clean up the sinuses. Now, as if this is not enough, I am a surgeon and I have performed what is called as sinus punctures. Couple of them in my life when I was in medicine. So what we do is, this sinus when it is full, we take a trocar. It's a very ugly sight to look at. We just put some anesthetic inside and we punch inside, literally force inside that sinus so that we can wash it. That's called sinus wash. And I have seen what comes in the kidney tray. You cannot even see that. It's all full of dirt and pus and what you can. That's all sinus feelings. Now, instead of reaching that stage, it's possible to purify them, clean them by using a method that you already has. It's been used for a number of days. And mind well, all these sages who performed this yoga, they were in Himalayas, an absolute right place to have common cold, but they never had it. They were never having it simply because this was always there. They had, and then as if the neti pot is not enough, look at the advertisement that I showed at the down below. This is an ad from an American magazine. They have come out with something similar to neti pot, and see the claims what they are making. Cleanses away the root causes of nasal congestion, nasal allergies, sinus infection, rhinitis and sinusitis. Is it not a neti pot? Our neti pot is much better than what they are advertising it here. What I am trying to say is people have started getting the results. Now, most important part is, what is the control of respiration? Why respiration is important? Because I want to have oxygen from outside straight to the alveolus where it will get purified, go to individual cells. Now the question is, this is the cage which breathes in and out. When it goes down or inside, it is pulling the air inside. There is a vacuum that is created in this cage. This cage is bound by the ribs. The ribs are bound by the muscles. So you can see those muscles. There are ribs and there are muscles. And there is a diaphragm. There is a muscle called diaphragm. Now, it's a very small muscle. I just want to point out to that particular muscle. This is the muscle. It's basically a very small, thin muscle. An amazing ability this particular muscle has. And most of the yogis are the only people who have actually lengthened this muscle. It's on record. It's by actual measurement, they do it. That's because the breathing that a yogi does, he precisely does, that is called diaphragmatic breathing. And why this is important is, if these muscles are not in proper shape, how much vacuum you create, that much oxygen you will take in. If you don't take enough oxygen, and I'll come to the figures and you'll be surprised, we all are breathing right now, but how faulty our breathing is, we'll come to know that. So that's why this is called a somatic nervous system. Why somatic? Because it's under my control. I decide not to breathe, I can't do it for a long time, but I can stop. It's under, because these muscles are under my control. And since they are under my control, then Guruji says, take a deep breath. I'm able to do that because it's under somatic nervous system. Then comes the second control, that is called autonomous nervous system. Now this is where that sympathetic and parasympathetic system I was talking about. Control, that is called autonomous nervous system. Now this is where that sympathetic and parasympathetic system I was talking about. This is not in our control. What happens when we see, we all have seen movies. That girl is going and this is first time going to meet the boy and she's nervous and she's breathing heavily. It's not a somatic breathing. She's nervous, she's breathing heavily, that's sympathetic nervous system. That's because that system has started acting on it. So sympathetic nervous system, whenever you are under anxiety, your breathing will change. Things that are not controlled by yourself, you get controlled by them, is under sympathetic and parasympathetic system. In parasympathetic, what happens? You're very cool, you're not disturbed by anything, you're breathing slowly, each breath is coming in a nicer way, parasympathetic system is dominating. Now, autonomous nervous system, as per medical books, cannot be altered. But Dr. David Coulter's book says the only system where autonomous system can be altered is respiratory system, and the only methodology of altering it is yoga. That means yoga has an ability to alter the autonomous nervous system. That means even you can control your anxiety. It's other way around. Anxiety is controlling us right now. Yoga allows us to control the anxiety and then control the breathing. And that's where the beauty of yoga lies. This autonomous nervous system has different functions. The sweating that you get when you are scared of anything, sympathetic nervous system. The heart rate starts pounding, sympathetic nervous system. The breathing increases, sympathetic nervous system. Shakiness in the body. He was so scared that he started shivering. That shivering is not voluntary. It is sympathetic nervous system. He was so calm that even when the tiger came in front of him, he was standing like a rock. Parasympathetic nervous system, right? This may have control from the mind, that is called volition and will. Somatic nervous system is volition. Anybody can expand the chest and reduce the spleen. Few can do the second thing, and that is because it is will. And will is controlled by the mind. And that is where you will find that in yoga, everything is done in a very slow, steady manner, There is no hurry. There is no, even if you try to do something very fast, Guruji comes and tells you, no, no need to do so fast. You got to be sahaja, satatya, ekagrata. This is the way yoga moves forward. Why yoga is a good exercise system? That is what we are trying to see simultaneously. And then comes the last nervous system, the last control. The brains themselves also control the respiration. That's why you must have seen that we always hear a word that, oh, he's on respirator, but they have declared him dead now. What happens is your respiration can still continue, you may be dead. That's possible because of these two centers. So whenever respiration is to be controlled, it gets controlled by three things: brain, autonomous nervous system, and skeletal nervous system. What I have in my hand? Skeletal nervous system. I can decide to breathe deep. Possible. That is somatic. I want to be very calm and quiet. Now it's a little difficult because I'm trying to control autonomous nervous system. No, I want to control my nerve centers. No, you can't. Because these centers work on the first two. So these three in together, that's called, these are three people, they go for a tango, and that is how respiration works. Now comes the question that how yoga affects breathing. Breathing is the only way to alter autonomous nervous system. There's something called 2:1 breathing. Now this is, I'm talking from medical point of view. If you inhale for, let's say, once and twice the length you exhale, that means what has happened is the uraka is 1, rechaka is 2. Inhaling is 1 and output is 2. If that happens, it is supposed to be a very ideal situation in medical studies. Why? Because when that happens, it is the only time when you get what is called as respiratory sinus arrhythmia. Now, this is not a disease. This is a natural condition. It happens with yogis. Classical examples are Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. When he was first seen by a doctor, he was shocked to see. He thought either there's something wrong with the stethoscope, because the heartbeats were very faint and the gentleman was breathing at the rate of about 3 breaths per minute. Something not heard of, because 12 breaths per minute is a normal standard. And then what happened was, it was Swamiji himself, Ramakrishna, coming out, because he was in Samadhi Avastha, he came out and said that, you should have told me earlier that you are going to check my heart rate. Now how it happened, because the reason is, he was into sinus arrhythmia. Now what happens is, when you breathe out fully, that's why you must have heard Guruji's words, jane do, tel ki dhar ki tarah, jane do. He's asking you to exhale more and more, exhale more and more. It's because that is the time when heart rate starts dropping. And when heart rate drops to a considerable level, there is no situation in this world where you are extremely angry and heart rate is low. It cannot happen. And it cannot happen other way around also, that heart rate is coming close to about 60 and he is very angry. Not possible. They are interrelated. So this is very simple. You control either the anger or control the heart rate. Control either the anger or the control the respiratory rate. In either way, what happens is, when you start counting, that's why keep your eyes and ears on the respiration, they say. Moment you do ekagrata on your respiration, what is? That's why even Kabir says, chadte utarte dam ki khabar le phir nahi aana padta. You keep alertness about how you breathe. Now why it is said, we think it is a doha of Kabir. No, it is a science behind it. That's called 2:1 respiratory sinus arrhythmia. Now talking about lung volumes. Now look at the first volume. It is so pathetic. You know how much air we breathe every time we breathe in and breathe out? It's just 500 ml. How much ideally it should be? The next is, one breath is 500 ml. When you do agnisara, 1600 ml we are breathing in and out. Now the thing is, we don't know the science of, if you know, he's just putting his, you know, the abdominal wall up and down, what is going to happen with that? Either you read the books or believe in what the Guruji says, because it has a science behind it. Can you believe Sarvangasana gives almost 1200 ml of one respiratory breath? Now in this 500, let me tell you one more thing. From nose to the last alveolus, there is a dead space, because the tube is a dead space. Tube is not coming into the action for a respiration. 150 ml is trapped from here to here. So 500 minus 150, 350 ml is what breath we take. And because of that, what happens? There is something called inspiratory reserve volume, meaning thereby, after I take a normal breath, if I decide to take a full breath, how much it will be, like this is my normal breath, and then I go for full expansion of chest, 3,300 ml. So imagine, I am taking in 500 ml, my chest can take 3,300 ml, 6 times more. I am supposed to breathe full. I am supposed to exhale full, but I don't do it. The only person who breathes properly in this world is infant below 3 months of age. It is only the child's breathing which is in this particular rhythm, where he inhales full, exhales full, and since we don't do it on a regular basis, at least we need to do yoga, where for time being, we breathe properly. That's why, in case of expiratory reserve volume, what is expiratory reserve volume? Suppose when I exhale out in a normal way, and I decide to empty my lungs, there is another 1 liter, 1000 ml of air that comes out. So when this kind of air goes further, then comes the question, what is your lung capacity? I'm talking about the volumes and now the capacity. Capacity means your power to breathe in and breathe out. Most important capacity is called vital capacity. I take breath completely inside as much as I can and I release it as much as I can. The whole cycle constitutes 4,800 ml. That is called yogic breathing. Imagine 500 ml, imagine 4,800 ml. Now what is happening is, with one breath, either both people have taken same breath. He is doing yoga, he is not doing yoga. The one who is not doing yoga, 500 ml. One who has done yoga breathing, he has taken 4,800 ml. Now, alveolus, where the gas exchange is taking place, the arteries are busy. They are picking up oxygen. Now the oxygen is going in quantity. The cells are flooded with oxygen. The cells are able to create as much ATPs as they want. And all of a sudden you feel, I'm feeling energetic. Look at his skin now. He doesn't appear anymore morose. Look at his luster of the skin. It's not luster. It is the ATP that is coming out. It's because I have pumped in the oxygen in the required quantity. Now there comes the question that when I was taking 500, kaam to chali raha, I was still working. When 4,800 comes, then the question is, why should I breathe so much? My respiratory rate starts going down. I give you a small example which will convince you, wherever you are sitting in your tomorrow, day after, wherever you are sitting, keep observing breath, the respiratory rate of the person sitting in the hall, sitting in the waiting room. You'll be surprised. I've seen it. They breathe 25 to 30 times a minute. With 500 ml, with 95 kilos of body, because how many cells are waiting for the oxygen, right? Moment you shed 1 kilo, billions of cells are reduced. No more oxygen is required for that additional kilo. And I've been carrying 15 kilos of extra weight on my body, I have a sack, for the last 20 years. There is a break point that is likely to come. Now in that case, we have what is called as functional residual capacity also. All these capacities that you see here are increased by leaps and bounds. Right now, if we take just a test on a meter called pulmonary meter, it's a pulmonologist, what he does is he checks all this. Right now, if we check it, we will get it highest in case of maybe Guruji, maybe Falguni, maybe Ashwini, because they breathe properly. They have taken the yoga to that extent, and that's why they're leading a healthy life. Why yoga is important? Because it works right at that particular system, which is the key to everything. Providing sufficient oxygen at sufficient pressure with sufficient percentages for sufficient period of time. That's why a yogi breathes, the yogic breath as they call it, is 3 per minute. Medical standard for an average healthy adult is 12 per minute. Most of us breathe at the rate of about 17, 18, 20, and there are some who are at even 30 also. More you breathe, more the system gets used, and that's why many a times in some of our books it is written that how much you will live depends upon how much you breathe. Number of breaths are counted and prescribed for you. That's why you need to understand one thing, are you going to be a tortoise or a tiger? Who lives longer? Because tortoise is calm, breathes slower, has very less flight, fright and fight instinct, and as opposed to that, with a great amount of speed, the tiger runs. He is fast, he is furious, he is angry, he is vociferous, he is aggressive. What happens to him? 15 years, versus 400 years. What you want is your choice. It is related to breathing, right? Then we come next to the pressure of oxygen. Many of us, we know that there is blood pressure. There is a pressure for the oxygen that you take in. When it goes to lungs, alveolus, it is 104 millimeters of mercury. When it goes into the arteries, it drops down to 100. And at the venous level, when it is completely exhausted, it is at about 40 millimeters of mercury. Why these three are shown is because if you do not have sufficient oxygen pressure, I'll give an example. If anybody has traveled to Ladakh, Leh, and that side, there's something called acclimatization. You fly to Leh, you cannot get out the next day for sightseeing. They tell you that you wait here for one more day. Your lungs are getting used to the low pressure. As you go up, the atmospheric pressure starts dropping. Atmospheric pressure starts dropping. Oxygen cannot go inside the cells. You may breathe, but it is at a low pressure. Now the question here is, people like us who are at a normal sea level, let's say, when they breathe, do you have sufficient pressure of the oxygen? We saw about the quantity. Quantity is fine, but the pressure is also important. Now what happens is, when the pressure is not sufficient, there are two ways I cope with it. One is, I breathe more. You start breathing more. What happens when you climb two, three staircases? You start panting and puffing. That panting and puffing is you're trying to grab as much oxygen as you can get, right? Now the question here is, yoga gives so much focus on this particular thing that it puts you under what is called as hyperventilation. Now hyperventilation, one of the classic hyperventilation is Kapalbhati. Guruji rightfully describes it. He says it is a charger. You charge your batteries. That's how the word he uses. There's not a single iota of exaggeration in that. There is no atishayokti in this. I'll tell you why. Look at the Kapalbhati. If you do it at two breaths per second, in a minute, 2 into 150, 150, because you're doing it faster, so naturally the amount of oxygen you will take will be less. It will not be 500, it will be 150. Actually, it can be 250 in yogis. But I'm taking a common man's example. In 2 breaths per second, multiplied by 60 seconds, multiplied by 150, that comes to 18,000 milliliters of oxygen going in. Why would it be called as a charger? Now, what happens with 18,000 milliliters? It is 4.225 times more than the normal breaths. One. Two, if you do it at 3 breaths per second, then it gives enough oxygen for climbing 40 stairs. Imagine somebody athletic has started running, has climbed 40 stages, how much oxygen he will require, that much you get in 1 minute in Kapalbhati. I believe this is more than enough an explanation for us as to why Kapalbhati is so critically important, so much emphasized. Right? And then, when it comes to that, what a yogi does, he always has a high oxygen in his blood, he has a low carbon dioxide concentration in his blood, and naturally he is always alert and energetic. He doesn't yawn. They always say, a healthy person sleeps less. Why he sleeps less? Why do you require sleep? Why we need sleep? What if I don't sleep? The reason is, it has taken so many years for medical science to find out. The latest discovery about sleep is 2013. And the discovery is that in sleep, all the activities that brain has undergone creates a kind of a waste matter that gets collected through cilia into micro tunnels, and they are ultimately released into what is called a cerebrospinal fluid. This discovery came in 2013. What it, simple words it means is, you cannot be calling guests and keeping the house dirty. Before you call the guest again, the house has to be cleaned first. So this cleaning is what you do when the guests, previous guests are gone and the new guests are yet to come. That period is called sleep. The question is, when you want to do that, I want to do it, I want to clean, but the problem is, I'm somehow not able to neend aane rahi hai. I'm not able to fall asleep, I'm not able to sleep longer, I get broken sleep, I get dreamful or nightmarish sleep. All this ultimately results from underlying subdued anxiety levels. Now when it comes to that, yogi doesn't have that kind of a problem. So we also need to see the type of breathing. We saw what is the volume of oxygen that is important, how you can increase it with yoga, how much pressure you can impart on that so that you inhale a larger amount of oxygen under sufficient pressure, like Kapalbhati. And now the last part is the types of breathing. The first breathing is the worst kind of breathing, called thoracic breathing. unfortunately, many of us have a habit of taking the tummy in because they don't want to show the tummy. So they take the chest a little ahead and they are walking and then they breathe accordingly. This is the worst breathing that you can ever think of. First of all, whichever natural shape your body has taken, your tummy is popping out because the abdominal muscles have lost their tone. You have never exercised them. You have never done yoga. So if it is there, it is there. At least by putting it in, when you try to pull your chest out and breathe, what happens is you get a thoracic breathing, which is shallow, rapid, and irregular. Where do you see these three kinds of breathings? You must have seen most of the times in our life, we have experienced this kind of a breathing. Whenever there is an anxiety, whenever you are feeling that, you know, something's going to happen, whenever you, even in the movies they show it, and that's the time when she's breathing very heavily. The whole thing is, it is coming out of the sympathetic nervous system. And that is the worst breathing that you can have. Why worse? Because it becomes an habitual shallow chest breathers. And then, overstimulation of sympathetic system. So you're always under anxiety. Such people always have high blood pressure because you're under sympathetic tone. And sympathetic nervous system does not attack only respiratory system. Once it is arousing, once it is given a jolt, it acts on cardiovascular and on every system. And that is why you have to go to the toilet again and again. Your tummy starts giving you trouble about digestion. You're not sleeping well. All these are manifestations of undue stimulation of sympathetic nervous system. In simple words, you are constantly under alert, hyper alert. And the person under hyper alert goes for this kind of breathing. Yoga completely discards this breathing. There is not one single exercise or posture in yoga where thoracic breathing is involved. But what they do is called empowered chest breathing. See the beauty, see where how the science has been taken into. Now, empowered chest breathing, and these four breathings I am talking from medical standpoint of view. What happens is, in empowered chest breathing, you do breathe through chest. But there are other aspects like accessory muscles are put under arrest. You are not using them. You are just using the cage. Now that is what precisely happens in Bhujangasana and Matsyasana. In these two, you're putting your hands down there and then you're stretching yourself. So what is happening is, only the cage is doing this. That's called empowered chest breathing. In our chest breathing, what happens is, I use all my neck muscles, I use my abdominals, I use my accessory muscles. There's a muscle here called sternocleidomastoid, the scalene muscle. There's so many muscles coming into the picture, so it's not a good breathing. But empowered chest breathing is one of the best. Then comes paradoxical respiration. Whenever you breathe, you can just now also test yourself. You breathe, your tummy goes out. You breathe in, the tummy goes out. You breathe out, the tummy goes in. Imagine reverse happening. You're breathing in and the tummy is also going in. That doesn't normally happen, but it does happen in what is called as Ujjayi. The abdomen is in while breathing and it kickstarts the sympathetic system. Now what happens is, it gives a jolt for release of adrenaline. The beauty about yoga is, adrenaline, if released on a continuous, sustained basis, it gives you a possibility of developing a blood pressure. But adrenaline is required for you to get that feel, what you call high, a good feeling. We'll come to that, what are the chemicals that get released. But yoga, only during Ujjayi, gives you a dash of adrenaline so that you suddenly become alert, you start feeling better, and that is when it stops. It doesn't keep you in that sustained state. Then we have what is called as abdominal breathing, which is the best and the must. We must master this. And there's a last breathing called diaphragmatic breathing. That's where that muscle which I showed you is used in the picture. This breathing is only possible for hatha yogis, accomplished siddhas. That's because they develop it accordingly. While developing this particular thing, the carbon dioxide and oxygen concentration in brain also goes up and down. So sometimes you feel dizzy. So it should be done under the guidance of a guru. But if mastered, which masters have done it, if mastered, yogis, they are constantly under diaphragmatic breathing, and that's why for them, they do not need to breathe much. They do not, because their one breath is the most ideal breath. The whole rib cage is widened, the chest becomes like a box with a complete suction power. So even if he does a normal breathing, that's why you must have seen in Buddhist monks or yogis, when they breathe very slowly. While breathing, they are extremely cool. There is absolutely no flutter on the mind, no thoughts running through the mind, they are just breathing. So that the whole oxygen that is drawn inside in one breath is sufficient Who else breathes so well? Person like Usain Bolt or Carl Lewis. For just for your information, the heart rate of Usain Bolt is 36. Carl Lewis had a heart rate of 32. 32 times pumping is enough for the body, and you saw the body, what body he has. He runs like a tiger. Why it is so? Because there is a balance between what is needed by the body and the element called heart and the respiratory system. But he is training hard for that 100 meters. Yogis do not train hard. They know this is important, but they devote some time of the day for that, and remaining time they are ready to use that energy in a positive manner. That's what happens with the different types of breathings. Now, what is the miracle of yogis? Now, these words which I am using are again coming from different research papers published by Western people. Not one word that I have spoken here is from any Indian literature. Because we all know about Indian literature, they are there, we have read it. But why? Because anything that comes from West, we get more convinced. And that's the reason perhaps why I have put it there. The fact is, there is no need for convincing. The reason is very simple. It is an empirical knowledge. You do it, you experience it, and you like it, and you follow it. There is no need to know any medical aspect of it, but our brains, they are extra inquisitive to know what is exactly happening. And that's where a yogi always have a very high oxygen concentration in his blood. A very low, and when I say low, it doesn't mean that it completely goes away. You require carbon dioxide also. You cannot have very low carbon dioxide. The lowest that you can think of, that you can go for. Then it releases adrenaline and serotonin. Now these are two elements which are constantly dripping or seeping in the blood of a yogi. That's why you say he is always hasat mukh rehte hai. Unke chehre pe tej hai. These are not crude words. What it meant that they are constantly experiencing those neurotransmitters which are called epinephrine, serotonin, adrenaline, gabapentin. These are all chemicals which you and me get, but we get it occasionally. In fact, when we say that I am very, very excited and happy, something must be happening inside. Because happiness is an expression. But here inside, something is nothing else but release of neurotransmitters. In case of yogis, it is constantly seeping in the blood because of the health that they enjoy. Coming down to this aerobic and anaerobic exercise. Why yoga is perfect aerobic exercise? When you do aerobic exercise, the amount of energy that is released is measured by adenosine triphosphate or ATP. 36 ATPs it releases with one phosphorylation or one glycolysis. In case of anaerobic, only 2. So those who are doing those dumbbells and barbells, what mistake they are doing is, first of all, they are increasing the size. So at first, they are increasing the oxygen demand. That means I need to now, because at the end, leaner I am, my requirement of oxygen is less. That's why the description of yogi goes as crusher. Somebody who is lean. Obesity was never there in the past. But the yogis knew what type of body frame you should have. That is why yogi has been described as somebody with a krusha sharira. He is always lean. Lean mass, because then his BMI goes down. The body mass index below 25. And just because body mass index, let me tell you, there is no single case on earth recorded so far with heart attack having BMI less than 19. Gandhiji was at 17. The reason is, lighter you are, flexible you are, your demand for oxygen is less, and you are so good and expert in getting that oxygen, you are in a win-win situation. And loss-loss situation, you are heavy, you don't know how to breathe, however you breathe is insufficient for you, and then you are in a loss-loss situation. So that is why yoga balances all the aspects at one point of time, and you don't have to worry about am I being taken care for X or Y or Z. Everything under the dome is properly covered. The muscular system, just a man has been just a bare open of the muscles. Now different types of muscles. Now can you see the abdominal muscles? We are all worried about it. We are not worried about whether I am healthy or not. We are worried about my paunch is being seen by people. That's the worst way of defining health. Paunch should not be there, but there are so many other things which are not there. But why paunch to me? Because cosmetically we don't feel it is good. The problem is, paunch is not cosmetically bad. It is bad from the health point of view. I'll give you a small example. Somebody who just passed away 2 days back, the great boxer, Muhammad Ali, Cassius Clay. I don't know if anybody has followed his boxing techniques. When he was very old, still he wanted to fight. And with George Foreman, they decided to have a match. Now, George Foreman was young. He was definitely more powerful. Ali was getting weaker because he was the age was not on his side. So everybody asked him, well, what are you going to do? How are you going to win this? He said, I have a plan. Now, I'm just trying to take this because it is related to yoga and how relevant it is actually. What all he did is, in entire preparation, 6 months for that fight, he was preparing his abdomen. Maximum punches he took on the abdomen. And he made his wall of abdomen as like a steel. And the whole exercise being devoted to abdomen, even his trainer was a little worried. He said, what about punches and other things? You're not concentrating much on that. He said, no, I want to make this as hard as possible. And look at the match. It is available. You can see the thing. It took for first 7 rounds. He was letting George Foreman play and hit him. And he kept on hitting on his body, mainly on his abdomen. He took all the blows on the abdomen. By 8th round, George Foreman was tired. That was the time he gave his one left jab and George Foreman was done. It talks about how important abdominal muscles are. And that's why it is very painful when Guruji says do cycling. We don't like it, I know that. But it has a much, much important role to play. When he does a boat pose and he tells you that not now, in the mind the clock is running very fast. I hope now sir says two. But no, he never says two. You feel it's very long. But what he's doing is he's trying to make your tummy muscles so strong because you need that. Now the question is, if you have that stronger abdomen and similarly other muscles, believe me, muscles are supposed to listen to you. Problem is we are listening to the muscle because it pains. Even in our initial yoga classes, half of the exercises we don't do. Although with a systematic preparation, Guruji is taking it stage by stage so that you reach to the ultimate goal. Unfortunately, it is for us that he is teaching us at no cost. Because for our health, not his health, he is extremely healthy. Yet, we don't attend regularly. After attending regularly, half of that we don't do. After he has done it and told us to do it home, we don't feel it is important. The reason is because we do not pay 4,000 dirhams to get a membership of a gym. When that 4,000 goes, I feel I must go there. When it comes easy, it doesn't. Same yoga, if it comes from USA, it becomes an important because then yoga mat becomes important for me. All my ancestors have been doing it on a chatai and it was giving equal amount of this thing. The whole concept is being very, very lopsided in terms of thinking about yoga and its importance. It's an effective armament of exercise given in the hands of people who don't deserve it. Unfortunately, we feel like saying that simply because we don't take it so seriously. And that is why, coming to the next part, exercises, there is one important aspect I just want to cover it, and that is when you do an exercise, your length of the muscle either goes up or down. Look at what I'm doing my biceps brachii. This muscle is pulling my forearm towards my shoulder, because of which what you see here is shortening of muscle and this is lengthening of muscle. This is called isotonic exercise. And this exercise is called isometric exercise. Exercise where the length of the muscle doesn't change. Entire yoga is isometric exercise. And it has been conclusively given in medical research and books that isometric exercises are the best. So it goes without saying that when you do asana, what you are doing is you are not stretching yourself. Your muscles are in the same length, but they are under resistance. That's called isometric resistance training, and that is why you find, and that's why most of the persistent misconception even in medical fraternity. Now let me tell you, amongst the doctors also, that includes me, because now I read it, I know about it. You always feel that right now this muscle is right beside my body. So it's at rest. It is not at rest. It has been found out that even when you are not using a muscle, the brain keeps firing the impulses to the muscle. It is only when we do shavasana that firing comes down. This has been seen on an electromyogram, a graph. When you do shavasana, you are actually lying on the flat on the ground. Guruji keeps telling, imagine your body sinking in the ground. It's just like lead. Start concentrating from your toes. Come up towards body. Believe as if you don't have any organ. Believe they are completely relaxed. concentrate. All this he is saying simply because he is trying to negate those impulses firing, which happens even when you are relaxing. And that relaxation is called complete relaxation, when the muscle doesn't have even single impulse. That is possible only in yogis and in shavasana. So relaxation, what yoga gives, no one else can ever try of giving. Then one of the reasons why we get low back pain, very, very common concept. Low back pain is so common, whether it is women or men, both. Simply because if you've been traveling, whether you're driving BMW or Mercedes, back is back. And it pains. Now, everyone feels that there is a back pain, that means there is a PID, but which is not the case. The back pain many a times happens mainly because of, you know, there's a muscle called quadratus lumborum, and there's another muscle called ilium lumbar ligament. These two things are classically approached by yogis and in yoga. That's why you're not likely to get any kind of backache, etc., if you're doing a regular basis the yogas. Now, I've given a background of yoga, medical aspect, respiratory system, musculoskeletal system, why yoga is great. It is important now also to actually see some of these asanas, and it gives me a great pride to present to you somebody who is doing this particular yoga with firm belief and faith. Shall I call Falguni on the stage? Gentlemen, you must welcome this girl, this lady, with claps for two reasons. She performs yoga the way it needs to be performed. That's one part of it. But the most important part is, she's a patient of cancer. She has undergone all therapies that you can think of cancer. But today, she's the most healthy person sitting in this class, that I can guarantee. And this guarantee has come not from me, but from the Guruji himself, who says that she does a better pranayama than him. Now, I would like to show some of the asanas and the differences where it comes. You can start with any of them, I can just explain that. Yes. Now, she's going to demonstrate you Kapalabhati. You've seen why it is important. See the rhythm. You will not get the sound of it. It will be done equal amount of inhalation and exhalation, and you can just see the movement when she's breathing. She'll exhale first. We'll have a little narration from Guruji also. See, the rib cage is completely expanding. The whole lungs are into the work to take in the gases, the oxygen. And it is small exhalation, inhalation patterns repeated with equal frequency. And another thing is, when we do this exercise, the guidance of a good guru is required. We have seen n number of varieties of Kapalbhati, making some of them enormous amount of noise. After doing this Kapalbhati, she has exhaled completely and she is holding the breath there in the exhaled condition. So she is not breathing.
Breathe in maximum.
See, now he is saying breathe in, that means he is taking maximum inhalation. How much quantity are we talking about? 4,500 to 4,200 ml.
Slow continuous.
See, now he is using the word slow continuous breathing. That means the exhalation is going to go longer. The heart rate will drop, she will feel calm. The medical aspect is, right now if you check her pulse rate, it will be definitely less than 65-60. That's where it must be. And the breathing rate is close to the vicinity of about 7 or 8. The perfect condition for calmness of mind. This is because of sympathetic nervous system. The paradoxical respiration that I was talking about. Normally when we breathe, the tummy goes out. Now here it's going to happen in a negative manner.
Exhale.
See, there is a ghrshan. the inhalation that is happening is actually going through the nose with the sound, because it is actually doing friction with the wall. So this is basically what is happening, is those, the cellular lining is getting stimulated. They will perform better mucus secretion, better ciliary action, and you will never get a problem like, I've got a pharyngitis, I've got a sinus problem, I've got a laryngitis, because this is where it is actually working. You are basically stimulating the linings, but not with your finger, with your breath. Look at the amount of abdominal muscle movement. See, with one force, she is releasing her abdominal muscles. She has a complete control on the abdominal muscles. She is pushing it out, pulling it in, pushing it out, pulling it in. Now what's happening is, simultaneously, when she is pulling and pushing, the diaphragm, which is separating the lungs from the digestive system, is going up and down like a piston. And this is called squeezing of lungs. So that's how her breath becomes a full breath. Second thing, because of in and out movement, the whole organ like stomach, intestine, which is suspended on a omentum, it's moving. It's a massaging of intestines and everything. A person who does this should never ever have a problem with digestive system. It also stimulates pancreas. So that's why yogis, when we feel hungry, we immediately try to find out where is the restaurant. A yogi can stay without it for a couple of days. How does he do that? He does it simply because when he does this kind of an agnisar, the pancreas gets stimulated, the glucagon is secreted from there, it goes to the liver immediately takes the stored glucose from glycogen, releases as a form of glucose, sufficient amount of glucose is released, cells are happy, he is not hungry, there is no food. That explains how yogis are, they can go without food for a longer time. It is all science. What more? This is for the ladies, there cannot be, and believe me, this is something which now medical science is realizing so fast. Most of the ladies have a problem because of after parturition delivery, the muscles of the pelvic floor, they become weak. It either leads to what can be termed as piles, fissures, or prolapse of the uterus, or n number of issues with the gastrointestinal tract. All this can be done because the most important muscle lying at the pelvis is called pelvic diaphragm. What exercise she is going to do is an exercise where that muscle will be also pulled up, and she is going to make the belly concave because she is going to pull the abdominal muscle inside. So,
complete breathe out.
She had done a chin lock, a Jalinder one. So this is stopped. The glottis is blocked. There is nothing, no air is going in here. She has also done a bandha at the anal end, so that also is tight. So between two tight blocked things, she has put the pressure on the abdomen to take it inside. So what is going to happen in this situation, there is an absolute muscle toning that takes place. And it also manages apana vayu.
Really?
This is another bandha that is so critical. Uddiyan bandha has been studied in detail by pulmonologists. So these are the ones, people who are suffering from asthma. People, apart the breathing exercises, because this tones up the abdominal muscles also. These were some demonstrations. Anything else we need to show or sufficient? Huh? Generally, one or two we can show. This is just to emphasize why what yoga can do. Demonstration per se, but just to show you that one asana takes care of how many muscles. Take any example of any asana, and I can explain you how many muscles come into the picture by doing it. Per se, but just to show you that one asana takes care of how many muscles. take any example of any asana, and I can explain you how many muscles come into the picture by doing it. Both the legs without the flexion at the knee have gone at 45 degrees. What is happening is her abdominal muscles are tight like a wall.
90.
Now she's taking it to the 90. And now she's going to take it right straight up. Now imagine, we always think that there's a lot of muscles that are coming only in the picture. You may not believe in this condition, the blood pressure is reversed. What has happened is, when I stand, my blood pressure at my this level is so low that my calf muscle has to pump the blood up, otherwise it doesn't come up. In this case, the whole blood is flowing towards the brain, towards the lower side, with higher level of saturation towards the central nervous system circulation. So anybody who does Sarvangasana, he initially feels a little bit of congestion on the face. And he's feeling tight. Her hip muscles all are in picture. The gluteus is in picture, the hamstrings are in picture, the flexors are in picture. You also have calf muscle coming in picture in one asana. And while going back, she's controlling it and going vertebra by vertebra. She's taking control and coming down with one vertebra touching the ground. What is happening is, she's occupied. So now when she takes breath, only chest is going to come into the picture. So she's doing Kapalbhati, she's pushing in and out the air. So in this particular condition, the Kapalbhati gives maximum effect. And they have been put so beautifully in a particular system. So as long as we follow the system, we will definitely get the result. She will release her neck, she's back, she's going to release her, flex this thing. Now imagine how many ligaments have already worked. There will be no issue happening in case while she walking outside, she trips, she will not have any problem with the ligaments. They are toned, they are into action. Our ligaments are not in action, we might come into a shock. That's very common. It's very, very common for back pain, and I can vouch for this because I myself suffered from the same issue. These are some exercises where she's going to do what is called an extension of the back. Now, what is happening? She's pulling this leg up as much as she can. So, with the result that the back has arched like this, that is called maximum extension of the back. Now, we can see that it's right, then the left side of the back muscle, and now both. See? Now, with this locus position, what is happening is the back muscles are absolutely tight. When you do this, the back is bound to vanish. It is so critical that people who are having backache can do this and get the results instantly. See, in this, what she is doing is, again, her respiration is going to be entirely unassisted respiration, which is purely what is called as performance thoracic breathing. That's what precisely she is doing. And this, she is also arching the back. In the previous asana, lower back was more arched. In this asana, the front back, the upper half, this side is getting arched. See that? You can't get a better arching of spine more than this. This is maximum the spine can arch. And with so much of flexibility is there in the spine, there is no way you can ever have a problem of back. Backache is nothing less but lack of exercise for the back muscles. The whole body is stretched to the maximum, and now she has arched herself like a boat. So with the result that back of the calf, back of the thigh, back of the back itself, the back muscles, and the neck, whole thing is arched. There's again a complete arching at all the places. She's precisely putting her fingers where it pains. And that's an area which we call as the lumbosacral area. That's where I refer to muscle called quadratus lumbar. Can you see the second last one? That's precisely where she's pressing and doing the arching. There's no way backache can continue to exist. Now, a scissor pose or pechi as they call it, what she's doing is, she's going to keep one leg of hers up there and then cross it over to the other side. See, now what has happened is, she's twisting the back. Back needs to be twisted. Now, you do a vertical twist, but this is basically what is called as a supine twist. Now, with this twisting, the muscles that are used are different than the previous one.
Right.
Believe me, these muscles what she is using, we do not use them for years together. Because we do not use this portion for exercise any time at all. Jeans do not have this. They do it for thigh, they do it for leg, they do it for this. But there is nothing that comes for the back per se. Again, it's the same arching but done in different ways. Now look at the flexion. Show me one single joint which is not flexed on the lower extremity, and the upper extremity is pulling it. So there is a resistance. Now I was referring to isometric exercise. This is isometric exercise. Every single muscle is within the same length, but it is put under resistance. That's what the beauty of yoga is. It doesn't require any prop. It doesn't require any weight to be holding the hand. It doesn't require a person to sit on the back. It just does it by itself. She's doing it rolling. Now imagine here. She's using entire lower extremity, entire upper extremity, at the same time the abdomen. The abdominal muscles are under pressure. Now, in one particular flexion area, these are all extensions happening in the arm. Those who are having pets at their home, especially a dog, this is a dog pose. Such a critical pose.
Right.
Now what happens here is, if you look at the balancing, apart the balancing part of it, what is happening is, by sheer weight of the lower extremity, it is her own leg and own thigh that is acting as a weight for lifting. So she is lifting on one side the entire one extremity. And at the same time, when she's trying to balance it, the back is coming into the picture. If there is no proper balance in the back, your back muscles are weak, you can't do this. So it's taking care of lower extremity, upper extremity, back at the same time. This is just to show. Can you see these muscles here? This is what she used just now. Now, believe me, this is called trapezius latissimus dorsi. These muscles are not used in any kind of exercise for years together. Because we walk, this is my torso, this is called torso, is absolutely upright, but I have never even taken pains to do this. Because very rarely I lift a pen or a pencil like this. But yoga is the only, that is the reason why orthopedics is the first medical faculty which is affected by yoga. In fact, maximum usage, that's why physiotherapists in orthopedics are now compulsorily required to know yoga. Because that's first instance, it's like when computer software came, accounting was the first job that went away. So yoga has immediate applications in orthopedics, but it has much wider applications in so many other aspects. I tried my level best to condense the whole thing into, not so short, but almost a 2 hours presentation. I must say that two things that we need to keep in mind. One is, it's a beautiful science, it's a beautiful exercise, it is a must for us, it is a must for our health. But it should be done only under the supervision of an absolute master or guru. Luckily, we have amongst us, and I have undergone the exercise, we still have it in our office. In my office, I'm a doctor, I have 2 cases of backache, diagnosed with prolapsed intervertebral disc, advised surgery, both have postponed the surgery. Now they are both thinking of participating in half marathon. Credit goes to and there is no this, it has happened in my office. And that's why become Guruji, the gentleman who spent his whole life for spread of yoga at no cost. Entire life he spent for it. Under his supervision and under his eyes, Guruji was trained. He has been giving his yeomen free service. Believe me, it is a thankless job. To correct somebody else's health at his own cost, he has been continuously striving to do that. So he must have been a great teacher. And the only wish I have is, we deserve to be healthy. I can understand somebody from Africa, America or Europe saying that, you know, I don't know how to be healthy. We cannot afford to say that because yoga belongs to us. We belong to India. We have dhana, which is called health, coming to us from 5,000 years. Let's live up to that. Let's be all healthy so that people will say that, because I have been asked this question by many foreigners when they came to study yoga. They say that, yeah, in India there are a lot many people talk about yoga, but I don't see them healthy. And that's a very shameful thing for us. Let's take it in a positive spirit. Let's make a decision that I shall start yoga in my life. I'll devote half an hour to 45 minutes of life every day for my remaining 23 hours and 15 minutes of healthy and positive life. Thank you so much. Oh yes, Guruji will announce about it. Yes, yes, we do have it at multiple places. Any specific question, anybody has any doubt in the mind as to, you know, how to ask? Many times that doubt lingers in the mind. So I believe that everybody is convinced, and Guruji will talk about the classes, and I pray for the God that all of you will become soon very healthy. Thank you so much.
Dr. Jadhav, he done such a wonderful explanation for the yoga. He just came to know a lot of scientific fact behind this. It's very interesting and very encouraging to us who practice yoga. And thank you very much, Dr. Jadhav. And also for giving this hall and arranging this one. Consular Sumati Vasudev, who cultural secretary, who arranged this program. It's also part of International Yoga Day. And also for Counselor Sandeep Chaudhary, he came here and he was actually very much part of our yoga classes. And he was here for a long time, and we thank him also for coming here. And also, I thank all of you for coming here. And few things, I think people are asking whether we have these yoga classes. See, we have every Saturday 9:30 to 11:30 in this hall. We conduct these yoga classes, and all are welcome. Anyone, your friends or somebody you want to come, you can also tell them. Every Saturday 9:30 to 11:30 we have here. It's a big hall. We are also, I think we have only using very little part of this. So if you want to utilize, we like to have more people coming here. And it is free, and you can tell anyone to come, and if they come regularly, it's good for them. And another class we conduct every Friday, 7 to 9 a.m. There is in the Bardubai, there is Badri Hall, where we conduct this yoga class. So people are also welcome for all that classes, and thank you very much.